I wrote the book because we live in an increasingly bureaucratic society, but nobody really talks about it. Back in the 70s, everybody was talking about bureaucracy, in the 50s even, the 60s, 70s. If you look at how often the word is used, for example, I did a Google search for this. It just goes up and up and up, and then suddenly it stops in the 70s, and people stop talking about it. Yet if you look at any word we normally associate with bureaucracy, paperwork, performance review, additional documents required, I fed all of these things into Google Ngram. Each one goes, goes straight up. So we have more and more bureaucracy, but we don't talk about it anymore. And I wondered why that was. And the other thing which really disturbed me was, insofar as anybody's making political capital out of this, it's the right. People's revulsion against this increasingly regimented bureaucratic society goes against government and the idea of social welfare. But in fact, most of the bureaucracy that exists nowadays is really a kind of neoliberal bureaucracy, which is a fusion of public and private, or is this plain private? It's corporate bureaucracy, which is essentially a means of extracting wealth from people. The very form that we have of capitalism nowadays is profoundly changed. It used to be that the money in Wall Street and the city and the big financial institutions was essentially money from corporations that were actually making and selling things. Increasingly, it's finance. And we think of finance as like sheer gambling speculation, but really what finance is playing around with other people's debts. Financialized economy means that large financial interests collude with government, essentially corrupt the system, and create a they talk about deregulation, but what that really means is creating new regulations which ensure that people are in debt, and they go trade the debt and speculate on the debt with one another. That's what happened with the 2008 mortgage crash, of course. Everybody's taking bets on how long it was going to take people to default on their mortgages. You have to create those debts. And that's done through bureaucratic means. And it seemed to be very ironic because it's almost like the Sovietization of the capitalist system. Now, we used to talk about state socialism as being this incredibly stifling bureaucratic system, but it was also utopian because what they imagined was they were going to create a new man, a kind of human who would correspond to certain ideals, which were in fact impossible. This is a standard critique of utopianism, that you come up with an impossible standard for people to live up to, and then when it turns out people don't live up to it, instead of blaming your expectations, you blame them and you put them in the gulag. Now, it seems to me that capitalism is actually operating that way. In fact, the major source of profits within capitalism is precisely utopian behavior. You look at a bank like JP Morgan Chase, something like 70% of their profits now come from fees and penalties. So let's say half of that is penalties. So half of the profits from the biggest corporation, or the biggest bank in America, perhaps in the world, I'm not sure, comes from essentially making up rules that you can't follow and saying, but any decent person, any reasonable person should be able to balance their checkbook. They make up this impossible ideal, and then when you can't live up to it, they punish you, except they take money. What the great problem with bureaucracy has always been that it creates a kind of a trap. The moment you try to address the absurdity of bureaucracy, somehow it always creates more bureaucracy. And the same with liberal reforms. Whenever they say, well, we need to get rid of this paperwork and red tape and sort of unleash the market and loosen things up and open the way for individual initiative and freedom, somehow those initiatives invariably create more paperwork, more regulations, more bureaucrats than existed before. I think this is an historical constant. I actually came up with a phrase for it. I call it the iron law of liberalism. There's never been an initiative to unleash the market and to limit bureaucracy that has not, in fact, created more. It's happening everywhere. I mean, America sort of leads the way. And another reason I wanted to write this to shine a mirror on America, because America, it's almost the opposite of England. When I came to England, I realized that British people are actually kind of proud that they're not very good at bureaucracy. Everything goes wrong, but they seem to feel like if we were good at this sort of thing, it would look, really kind of counter our self-image of what we're really like. With Americans, it's exactly the other way around. They're incredibly good at bureaucracy, and they hate themselves for it. It just doesn't fit their model of what Americans should be like. We're rugged individualists. But in fact, what they've created is an incredibly bureaucratic society, and they've imposed it on the world. As some people have pointed out, the British Empire never created vast planetary bureaucratic institutions. As soon as America sort of took over the mantle from Great Britain after World War II, what was the first thing they did? They created the IMF, they created the World Bank, they created the UN, all of these planetary bureaucracies. And over the course of the 80s and 90s, those bureaucracies were turned into means of enforcing a certain neoliberal hegemony. And my really first political awakening as an activist came in the alter-globalization movement. And after all, I realized that what this basically is, it's an anti-bureaucratic movement. There is this planet-wide bureaucratic system with a means of enforcement, which the UN never really had. And this is a first. This had never really happened before in human history, and it was entirely an American creation, sort of inflicted on the rest of the world.